Welcome to Renew Your Life.
Our scripture reading will be coming from Psalms chapter 103, verses 1 through 12. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executeth righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. He made known his ways unto Moses, his acts unto the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word.
You are the risen King, and you sit in majesty. First chapter of Joshua, please, if you have your Bibles and your devices. First chapter of Joshua. I want to read one verse, please. Verse number 3, and then we're going to share what the Lord has laid on our hearts. Well, let's begin verse number 1, Joshua chapter 1. We'll begin verse number 1. Now, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give unto them, even to the children of Israel. And here is the promise. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. Will you read 3 with me together? Every place the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. Before you take your seat, will you edify someone, smile at someone, say, walk on what he just said. Oh, that person didn't have enough Holy Ghost. Look at somebody else and tell him, walk on what he just said. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. If there's any value, virtue, if there's any area that can be categorized, that we can talk about as it relates to Joshua, is the mentality's attitude regarding obedience. I think this is a classic case for us to recognize that the hand of the Lord was placed heavily on Joshua because of his obedience, because of his connection, because of his reliability as far as Moses was concerned. And there are many attributes that we could share today, but this is the one that seems to rise above the rest, that this is an individual, Joshua has been one that has come through with Moses. It's going to be critical now that we pay attention to those who come through with you, those who go through with you. I know we spend a lot of time talking about the things that we've lost and the individuals that might have departed, but I want to emphasize, and I think you ought to emphasize in your own life, pay attention to those who hang in there with you through the thick and through the thin. Joshua stayed connected to Moses through the inception of his life. And one of the attributes that I think ought to be evident and ought to be realized in every leader is this attribute of obedience. And so the issue is that Joshua served his mentor, served him with such a spirit of respectfulness, subservience, that it catapulted him to this level of importance, of prominence. And here's God showing us that if you really want to go higher, if you really want to develop more meaningful positions with God, have service in your heart as part of your arsenal of gifts. It is not proclaimed, it's not a spiritual gift, but in other words, Joshua was just faithful. One of the things that we have to recognize, and one of the things that we have to stir up, even in the kingdom of God, the body of Christ, is the idea that faithfulness is going to be the key that attracts God in terms of promotion and blessing. Yeah. Notice what the writer taught us in Matthew 25. After all is said and done, after we've lived life, after we've raised families, after we've achieved things vocationally and spiritually, after we have been successful in the area of business, after we have launched ministry, launched business, after we have done tremendous things in life, here is the promise of God, or here is the response of God. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. After it's all said and done, after people have congratulated us and others have esteemed us, God, in his statement of congratulations, includes this virtue of faithfulness. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. And I believe that it's something that God aspires to because he is faithful. And he recognizes faithfulness, steadfastness, assurance. He recognizes assurance in everything that he does. And when faithfulness is a part of your life, you're going to be in business with God because he recognizes an attribute that he is, and he will bless all of us who demonstrate this area of faithfulness. Check faithfulness. When you're trying to figure out who you're with, check the level of faithfulness. Check the level of loyalty. Try and figure out those who will go through everything with you. It's noticeable here that Joshua now is, God raises him to the place of prominence because of his respect
for his mentor. He positions himself subservient to the man of God because he recognizes there's much that must be attained and there's much that must be learned as he's walking with the man of God, as the man of God is walking with God, which clearly states, teaches us that sometimes we've got to walk with individuals who are walking with God. Sometimes we have to choose carefully those relationships around us. Want to be in a position to be around someone who will raise us and not diminish us, who will increase us and not subvert us. There are some elements in our life that will push us ahead. There are others that will keep us back. Joshua put himself in a position that he will serve a man that was going somewhere. Anybody get that? I want to be in a position where I know if I'm with you, you've got to be going somewhere. And if you're following God, then if you're being subject to his will, then I want to be around anyone who has an aspiration and a vision to follow God. Joshua then, he recognized the hand of greatness on Moses. And this is one of the things that God will do as he increases our insight and our discernment about where you are. One of the things that we must do as we intend to go higher in God, we've got to be closely aligned to the environments that God brings us through, because everything that God brings us to and brings us through is to make us and to shape us into who we're becoming. And so now we can't always complain about what we go through. There's a tendency for us to do that. And I'm talking now specifically to the one who's always talked about why is my life the way that it is, and why is it that I've had to handle things that nobody else has to handle? Why does there always seem to be a weight on my life? Not only do I have to carry myself, I've got to carry people in my family, I've got to carry people around me. In the natural, it might look like that, but can I encourage you that if you have been able to carry a weight in the natural, God says, I'm getting you ready to carry the weight of glory, the weight of anointing. Some of us are accustomed to going through. Some of us are accustomed to handling heavy things. It simply means that God's getting ready to entrust you with an assignment. Because you have been faithful over carrying weights, then God can trust you with the enormity of the blessing that's coming your way. I want a blessing so much that just like Peter and Luke, I've got to call people to help me with my increase. Can't carry it by myself, but I need God to equip me with individuals who know the hand of greatness is there. And so Joshua recognized the hand of greatness on Moses, and he served him as he served the purpose of God. He served him as he served the purpose of God. He saw that there was a lateral move that was getting ready to happen. And this is why everything we do in ministry is environmental. You want to make sure you get in the environment. Sometimes we get real selective about where we sit in ministry and what seat we should acquire. I'm just glad to get in the building, because it's the environment that's going to bring us to where we need to be. And so whether I'm in the front or the back, the anointing has got to be there, because it's already in the house. Somebody say it's already in the house. We don't care who brings the blessing in. If God favors you, I'm going to celebrate with you. If God brings you into new levels, I'm going to celebrate with you, because all it means, if God is blessing you on the left side of the building, even though I'm in the back of the building, it doesn't make a difference, because it means that the blessing is already in the house. And if I stay faithful to God, victory is going to be mine. It was the assignment of Moses to lead Israel out of the greatest enslavement after 400 years of going through. Talk about somebody going through. Israel went through this place of confinement and enslavement for 400 years. They lost generations. They lost faith. So much so that the Bible declares, and the writing helps us to understand, that a new Pharaoh came into the leadership role in Egypt, and here's the issue, that did not know the forefathers, did not know Joseph, had no idea, even though Israel regarded themselves as holding on to culture, yet those that they lived with in Egypt, the Pharaoh did not know who their God was. And sometimes you've got to be careful when you're going through things that you don't forget who you are and forget the God that has brought you this far. Don't forget how it's been rough, I understand, but never forget the hand of God that brought you to this place. And even though, like Israel, we might be in about 400 years of enslavement, I think that God's getting ready to move something, because something has got to change. Have you ever been there where you just look at everything you're going through and you declare in your own mind, this thing right here has got to change. I can't look at this every day. This can't be a part of my life anymore. And what you're saying to God in your praise, how many know your praise communicates to God what you need from him? My praise is saying something has got to change. Every time I lift my hands spiritually, supernaturally, I'm saying something is getting ready to change. It's the level of my intensity that I believe that God's going to do this. So after 400 years of enslavement, Moses then has the task then of bringing Israel out of enslavement, and not just out of being physically bound, but being mentally abused. Here now he has to preach to a people that have almost forgotten how good their God is. And the fathers and the mothers have passed away. And so God lays his hand on Moses and says to Moses, I'm going to give you this first assignment to bring Israel out. Now Moses says to God, I'm not worthy. I don't think that the task is mine. And by the way, God, do you not know that I can't really talk that good? Isn't it like God to give you a talking assignment and you're still learning how to talk? Isn't it like God to give you a walking assignment and you're learning how to talk? We're learning how to walk. God does not have to call you when you are complete. All he wants you to do is to obey the call. And in the obedience to God, everything he needs to heal will come to pass. And so the second assignment then was to manage their journey through the wilderness. And so Moses had two major assignments. Understand this, that the assignment called, it was a three-call assignment, but Moses was called to handle the first two. Get Israel out and get Israel through. I think there's a praise on that. God, sometimes I just need you to get me out, and I just need you to get me through. I don't know how I'm going to make it the rest of the way, but God, if you get me out and if you get me through, then I know you. I can look back and tell the enemy, he has not brought me this far for me to lose my mind. He has not brought me this far. I don't hear praises yet. He has not brought me this far to leave me in a wilderness, because if he brought me out and he brought me through the next level, he's going to bring you in. And I need God now to bring me in to everything that he has desired for my life. And so he has to bring them through the wilderness. But it was not the assignment of Moses then to bring Israel in. It was his assignment to lead them out. It was his assignment to lead them through. But it was assigned to Joshua now to lead them to a place that they'd never been before. And so while sometimes God will use someone to get you out, while God will use a different person to get you through, thank God that everybody has a Joshua that's going to bring you in to everything that God ever designed your life to go in. If this makes any sense, lift your hand and say, Lord, bring me in. Lord, bring me in. I know I'm going through. I know you brought me out, because I'm not the way that I used to be. And I know I'm going through. But in order for me to sustain my faith, Lord, show me who you're going to connect me to bring me into my gift. Bring me into my anointing. Bring me into my fulfillment. And I won't get sad, because the person who brought me out and brought me through is not the one that's going to bring me in. Any way you want to bring me in, God, I'll celebrate you for who you are, because God is going to bring me by assignment. If you're out there, somebody holler, by assignment. Don't get hooked to an individual. I'm hooked to an assignment, because you don't know who God's going to use to bless you. Can I just divert here to say, this is why you can't afford to put your mouth on nobody in this season, because you have no idea who God's going to use to bring you out. I don't hear the church yet. You don't know who God's going to use to bring you through. And I wouldn't talk about you, because I don't know if God's going to use you to bring me in to what God has has positioned in my life. It is noteworthy then that Joshua did not face a challenge for position after the demise of Moses, because he was already in position to serve. This is why serving God is the prelude to be used by God. He did not have to fight to be the leader of Israel. He was already in position. Somebody missed it right there. You are already in position. Your struggle has positioned you to be what God has called you to be. The struggle in your life, the pain and the remorse in your life, why you complained about what the enemy was doing, God said, I'm just positioning you to be ready to handle the weight of responsibility over your life. So Joshua didn't have to fight for that. It's already yours. Will you smile at someone, tell him it's already yours? You don't have to fight for what God already ordained for you to have. Because Joshua walked with Moses, talked with Moses, understood Moses, God positioned him now to move into authority once after the demise of Moses. Position is literally rendered a place, a location, a spot. It's designated for someone or for use by someone, which means the place that God has for you already has a reserved sign on it. Can nobody get that? Yeah, we're trying to fight the wrong battle. You can have this one. I've got something reserved. You can release that. I've got something reserved. Anytime you roll up in a parking lot and see a reserved parking space, you'd be out of your mind to park somewhere that's not reserved for you. And just to make sure everybody knows it's yours, God says it's reserved and your name is on the sign. If you ever knew what God had in store for you, you'd walk out of the bondage today. If you ever knew what God had in store for you, you'd get through the wilderness and believe God, because now a place has been designated, has been chosen, has been set aside. And God says, because you served and you did not quit, because you struggled and you did not give up, because you hung in there when the devil was striving you crazy, and because nobody understood your relationship with Moses. Sometimes folk don't understand your relationship with other people, but what you don't seem to understand, I'm not here for position. I'm here to be positioned so God can bring me to a different place. I feel God in here now. Somebody holler, get in position. Take the whipping and stay there. I heard David say, and one thing have I desired of the Lord. I don't hear praises yet, and that will I seek after, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. Stay there when you're confused. Stay there when you're not sure how things are going to work out. Because I heard the prophet say, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Joshua did not have to fight for position, because what he did not know, that the time in the place, he was promoted to a place, but he had to suffer first. I don't think you get it yet. He was promoted to a place, but he had to suffer first, which means you've got to bear the weight of where you're going before you get there. Now, let me help you here. You've got to bear the weight of where you're going on the level you are now. Some of us are waiting for God to raise us up and then equip us. But God says, I'm going to put a weight on the level you are now. And if you can survive how you suffer on this level, if you can go through on this level, this weight is greater than your anointing. But God says, I'm getting you ready to handle a greater anointing by putting a weight on your life. Sometimes they will match boxers based upon their weight. Lightweights fight lightweights. Middleweights fight middleweights. Heavyweights fight heavyweights. But God said, on the middleweight level, I'm going to put a heavyweight anointing on you. And if you can survive this fight that you're in, I feel something pushing me here now. If you can survive the fight that you're in, if you can handle the level you're on, God said, I'm going to give you a heavyweight anointing on a middleweight level. But in order that's how you know God's getting ready to move you, because what you're going through is greater than the level that you're on. But But if God releases a greatness in your life, all it means is that you're getting ready for another level. Somebody holler, get ready, get ready. God's getting ready to move you. Yes, the stress has been great, but great is the Holy One of Israel in the midst of us. He was designated, or in the Greek, he was chosen. The electos is what he experienced, which means that God picked out and chose by God the assignment that he would need to handle. Now, what's critical here is that Joshua does not know this is what he's being prepared for. He does not know that everything that he's doing with his mentor is set to bring him to a place of prominence. But electos says you've been picked out and chosen. You were chosen for it before you are it. This is why John makes sense. He said, beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. You can be chosen, and it has not yet appeared what you're going to be chosen for. But you've got to hang in there with the struggle and tell the struggle, don't leave me too soon. Don't leave me unprepared for my assignment. Don't leave me ill-prepared for the anointing that I need. When was the last time you told your struggle, stay in my life until all of me is done? Stay here until my praise is complete. Stay with me until God brings me to where I need to be. Stay with me until God begins to understand who you are. Tell the storm, stay here long enough to perfect what I'm going through. Stay here long enough to get my mind together. So by the time I get to the next level, I'm not going to lose my mind up there. I'll lose it down here. But when I get up there, I need my mind to believe God. You are elected and chosen. You're in the utter understudy position now. But God says, I'm going to make you a joint heir with Christ. I'm going to get you ready for something that God is getting ready to move in your life. So be the understudy. Did you hear Jesus when he taught that the first shall be the last, and the last shall be the first? And if you hang in there long enough, I wish I had 1,000 believers now. If you hang in there long enough, God's going to cause the struggle to push you to where you need to be. I've got to close here. But I was watching the other day the Olympics, and this was a marathon race. They were running for hours, or they were running for an hour or so. And as they neared the finish line, as one person passed the other, there was a man that was leading the race, and it looked like he was the one that was getting ready to move, or he was the one that was getting ready to win. Somebody came from behind him, and in the last 10 meters of the race, he passed the one who had been leading. The one that he passed got upset with the person who passed him, and as he passed him, he hit him in the back, thinking that that was going to stop him from advancing. But can I tell you what happened when he hit him? The energy of the blow propelled him to go quicker and faster than you've ever been. I need you to know, every blow that you get, I wish we could have a little church right here. Every blow that we get is to advance our cause. Every time the enemy strikes you, it is not to bring you down. It's to propel you to the end of your experience and to believe that God is going to do just what he said. Somebody lift your hand and say, let the devil hit me, I'm still going to make it. I'm still going to believe that God is going to make a way. Can we have a little church now? Somebody open your mouth and say, I'm going to make it. I'll take the blows, I'll take the knocks, I'll take it. I'll keep believing that God is going to make it happen. And so here is Joshua trying to figure out what's happening and believing God for the next level. I need God to do this. And so to convince Joshua that I was with you, I was with Moses, I'm going to be with you. He said to Joshua, be of good cheer. You got to get up from where you are. You got to have to take responsibility for everything that you're going to go through. Because as I was with Moses, so I'm going to be with you. Does anybody believe God is with you? Lift your hands all over the kingdom and say, God, I know you're with me. I hear the prophet say, when thou passest through the waters, I'm going to be with you. And if you go through the fire, it shall not overcome you. And so God has a conversation with Joshua. He said, arise from this place. I feel God in here now. He said, where you are is not the end of your journey. Moses brought Israel out. Moses brought Israel through. But I'm getting ready to bring you in to a promise you've never had before. Is there anybody ready to go in? Is there anybody ready to go to believe God like never before? And so because of this, he says to Moses, he says to Joshua, Moses is off the scene, but I'm still here. It doesn't matter who leaves you, but I'm still here. It doesn't matter who locks you out. He said, but I'm still here. I'm believing God is going to bring me in. And so because of this, Joshua has to get up from where he is. I feel like talking to somebody now. Air high five your neighbor. Tell him, get up from here. This is not the last thing that God will do for you. This is not the last place that God's going to identify himself. This is not the last time that God will move on your behalf. He said, Moses, my servant is dead, but I know he's in. Moses went down, but at the time that he put Moses down, he raised up Joshua, because God is doing something different. Other folk are going through changes, but the Lord is raising us. The Lord is opening doors that we can't see. And I believe God and the promise he gave to Joshua. The promise was this: every place, I know you're not in the place yet. I know you're not in Canaan yet, but can I give you some marching orders? He said, every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, he said, I'm going to give you what you tread upon. If you got the nerve to walk all over Canaan, I'm going to give you what you claim. I don't hear you yet. I'm going to give you what you desire. If you open your mouth to make it known, he said, I'm going to give you the whole country. I got to close here, but can I tell you this? When God promised my God, when God promised Joshua that Canaan was his, I need you to inform you about something. In Canaan were the Canaanites. In Canaan were the Amorites. In Canaan were the Perizzites. In other words, God can give you something that somebody else already has. But don't get nervous. God said, I'm going to give you the territory. I'm going to give you the authority to take the territory. And if you've got the nerve to live, if you've got the nerve to fight, if you've got the nerve to be accepted, if you've got the nerve to try God. And so Joshua jumped up. He said to Israel, I hear God, and I'm going to walk on what God just said. I know there was a word from Moses. I know there was a word for his people, but there's a word for you. And the word of the Lord is, if I told you to walk, I know it's occupied. I know somebody else has your miracle, but I dare to walk on what he just said. He just said, you're going to be healed. He just said, you're going to be delivered. He just said, you're going to be free. And if I were you, I'd walk on his promises, walk on his revelation, walk on everything that God said he should have. Give your neighbor air high five and tell him, walk on what he just said. I just heard him say that he's bringing you out. Walk on what he just said. I just heard him say he's bringing you through. Walk on what he just said. I just heard him say that he's bringing you in. Walk on what he just said. Somebody lift your hand and holler, walk on what he just said. I hear life, keep walking. I hear love, keep walking. I hear victory, keep walking. Somebody open your mouth and holler, keep walking, keep believing. I'm walking on what he just said. Open your spirit. Somebody lift your hand and shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Walk on his promises. Walk on the vision. Walk on the belief. Walk on it. Walk on it. Walk on him. Somebody clap your hands and holler, I'm walking. I'm claiming territory. I'm claiming victory. I'm claiming power. I'm walking. I'll put my foot on my next miracle. Put your foot on your next breakthrough. Put your foot on your next coming out. Put your foot on it and see, in the name of Jesus, I claim my increase. I claim my increase. I claim my next level. I claim it. I put my foot on it and I claim it. Clap your hands all over the place and shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Open your mouth. I'm gonna walk on what he just said. Oh, I'm gonna walk. What did he just say? What is it? What did he just say? What did he just say to you? I am trying to give you the instruction of Joshua. God said, whatever you hear me say, decide right now, I'm going to respond to what God just said. Here is the issue. Joshua, you're going to have to get over some things. Come on, smile at somebody. Say, get over it. Get over it. There are some things you're going to have to get over. It sounds so insensitive. My God, it sounds so insensitive. But God tapped Joshua on the shoulder and said, listen, it's time for you to get over Moses. You would have thought that God has been through bereavement counseling. You'd have thought that God would have been able to talk to Joshua in a persuasive way. But God tapped him on the shoulder, trying to help somebody right now. There are times that God is going to be your confidant. He's your confidant. He's going to be your rock in the weary land. He's going to be your bridge over troubled waters. But there are times when God just has to tap you on the shoulder and tell you, get over it. Moses is already gone. Why are you sitting here crying when I'm getting ready to give you a word of authority? Oh, I feel God's presence here. Now, why are you still upset with, you can't be upset with God. How are you going to be upset with me? If I took Moses, his life wasn't over, but his assignment was. And here's the truth of the matter, Joshua. If Moses stays, then your assignment is going to be suspended. Moses has to leave for your time of preeminence to come. And so even though it looks like it's a difficult time, God said, I've got an assignment for you, and here's the promise I'm going to give to you. Whatever you say, whatever, wherever you place the sole of your foot, I don't care who has your house. Go ahead and walk around it anyway. I don't care who has, I don't care who has what you desire. God said, if you have the power and the sense to step on what I'm getting ready to say to you, I want you to walk on what I just said. This word is really about listening to God. It really is. It's about listening to God and reacting to what God says in a way that is more convenient. Many times we hear from God and we do absolutely nothing with it. But my instruction to you today is, when you hear God speak, walk on what he just said. Make a move on what God just said. Because I'm believing God. Joshua, if you want all of Canaan, put your foot in all of it. if you want just the northern part of Canaan, then that's where you're going. But if you want the entire place, I need you to walk. I need you to believe God in a certain way. I'm getting ready to pray. But somebody still does not understand that in order to come into preeminence, you have to suffer first. Joshua didn't want the assignment. Joshua didn't even know he was being prepared for the assignment. Somebody doesn't know right now, what are you being prepared for? God said, I had to bring you through a season of suffering, of confusion. Then, I'm not trying to hurt somebody right now, but then God says, I've got to bring you through a season of loss. I got to cause you to lose something. But in the losing, God said, you're going to gain something. You lost Moses, but you're going to gain the authority you need. Because here it is, as long as Moses lived, then Joshua was subservient to his tutelage and to his mentorship. In other words, Joshua could not come into his own until loss preceded him accepting his assignment. So God said, you'll lose sometimes. You will lose. You will lose. But God says, all loss is not to be mourned. Is anybody hearing what I'm saying today? I'm saying all loss is not to be mourned. Because once Moses has transpired, it opened the door for new life. Canaan would not have been possible because it was not the assignment of Moses to bring them into the place. God said, the last stage, you're going to suffer, you're going to cry. But you know when God's getting ready to bring you into something amazing, because you're going to go through loss. It is through the season of loss that we find what God has in store for us. And we're believing God. I'm praying with uplifted hands all over the kingdom, all over the building. I'm praying that you survive the loss. I'm praying that you clear your mind long enough to receive the promises of God, where God will say, every place that you, the sole of your foot shall tread upon, I want you to get it in your heart, Lord. I'm getting ready to walk on some things that I didn't believe were mine. I'm getting ready to walk on some things that I didn't understand, that I didn't know was here. I'm getting ready to move into a place that I didn't understand. Oh God, with hands lifted towards God, all over the kingdom, all over the body of Christ, the Lord says, I'm speaking now expressly to you, and I need you to follow my instruction. I need you to believe God for who you are. Get ready to walk. Get ready to walk. Somebody said, Lord, I can't do it. I can't handle it. I can't go through it. It's too great. But the Lord said, I'm going to cause you to overcome the hurt so that you can walk into the promise of God. I'm praying, Father, in Jesus' name, I believe God. I believe your word today. I thank you for the liberating power of your word. What an awesome place we're in. Thank you that my suffering positioned me. Thank you that my paranoia positioned me. I didn't know that's what you were doing, and I would have appreciated you telling me that's what you were doing when you were doing it. But God, you withheld that part from me. But Lord, I thank you now for bringing me to this place where I get the opportunity to go into something that I didn't think was possible. I'm praying for all the Joshua spirits right now who've had to overcome the greatest hurdle of their lives, the loss of something significant in their experience. But God said, it's time for you now to walk. You were sitting in it. I hear 137 Psalms preaching loudly. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, we wept when we remembered Zion. God says, you've got to stand up now. You've got to be able to walk with tears in your eyes. You've got to be able to praise me with tears in your eyes. You've got to be able to worship. You've got to be able to do what I've asked you to do, even though physically you may not be understanding it. Father, I pray now in the victorious name of the Lord Jesus, someone who does not know the Lord, someone who's getting ready to come into the fullness of God, someone who's getting over something but also getting ready to come in. The Lord said, I'm bringing you out, but I'm also bringing you in too. And whatever you've lost, can we pray the prayer of Paul? All things I count but loss, if it means that I win Christ, I'll count it lost. James teaches us in chapter 1, count it all joy. You go through diverse temptations, knowing this, that it's the trying of your faith that worketh patience. Lord, we thank you for your word that's been declared here today. Thank you for the power to come out. Thank you for the power to go through. Thank you for the power to go in. But God said, walk on what I just said. Whatever God is saying to you right now, take a moment, listen to the Lord. The Lord is sending instruction. He's sending direction. He's sending revelation. Whatever God says, God said, I want you to walk on what I just said. Even if it defies how you're feeling emotionally, walk on what I just said. Believe that God's going to do it. And I'll bring it out. We bless now you, God. Someone who's receiving Christ Jesus, come on in, come on in. The Lord is calling you. I believe that the Lord's trying to save somebody right now. We offer Christ to you, oh my brother. We offer Christ to you, oh my sister. God wants to offer Christ to you right now. Whatever it is that you're going through, walk on what I just said. If God says you're going to be saved, walk on that. If God says you're going to be healed, walk on that. If God says you're going to be delivered, walk on that. If God says I'm going to increase you, walk on that. Believe that God's going to do it for you. We pray these things in the victorious, matchless, efficacious name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we say, God bless you. Clap your hands all over the kingdom. Come on, clap your hands all over the kingdom. Come on, take a moment and thank him for Odaba. Take a moment and thank him for what he's already done. He's sending a word for you to walk on. He's sending a word for you to walk. He's sending a word for you to walk on. Walk on it, child of God. Walk on it, walk on it, walk on it. Walk in it, walk through it. Oh, God's going to give him a tremendous praise in this place. Oh, Malaya, give him a tremendous praise in this place. I believe God. Somebody send up worship. Thank you for what you're getting. Walk on. Come on, come on. Open the food of your, open your mouth. Give God the food of your spirit. I decree for you to walk out of it. I decree for you to walk through it. Thank you, Father. Walk on the promises of God. Walk on the promises of God. Walk on the promises of God. Oh my yes. Come on, lift those hands again. Oh my yes, Father. Oh my yes. I believe you, God. I believe you. I believe you. I believe you. Come on, let it increase your faith. I believe you. I believe you. God, we thank you. Lift those hands, Hayabarasha, and now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done. Ubashe. For us, come on, bask in his presence. And now, let the weak say, I am strong. Feel strength today. Let the poor say I am rich. Worship it right where you are. Receive the strength of the Lord. Receive the strength of the Lord. Receive the strength of the Lord. Receive the power of the Lord. Receive it in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father. Do it in this hour. Do it in this moment, Lord. Whatever it is, we need you to move. I'm getting ready to walk. Thank you, Father. Joshua had to walk even when he was unsure of what God was going to do. And I challenge you, it's not going to be easy. It's not going to be easy. Like a child taking their first steps, it's not going to be easy. But the Lord has given us a commandment. He's given us a promise today. He has promised and believed us that he's going to do what he promised he would do. It's not going to be easy, but keep on walking. Look towards somebody, smile at someone, tell them it's not going to be easy. But God wants you to keep on walking. I know it's going to be uncertain, but I'm going to walk on what he just said. Even when I don't get what he's saying, even when it doesn't compute, it doesn't add up, I don't get it. But if I know that it's God, I know that God's going to be glorified. Clap your hands all over this room and give him praise and glory right here. Believe God for who he is and for what he's going to do in our lives. Hallelujah. 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 I'm going to pray one more time. I'm believing God. The presence of the Lord is here today. The presence of the Lord is here. And I'm believing God for the manifested word. All that God's going to say and do. Many of us may have prayer requests. Can't do an altar call, but I can still make the call. But I'm calling on your hearts and believing God. And if there's something that you need God, I'm really feeling the courage to do what you know the Lord has called you to do in spite of the things that come against us. And so I'm going to close with a simple prayer, and a simple prayer of courage. God's going to give you courage. Just like he gave Joshua courage, he's going to give you courage today. Father, now, thank you for the strength. Thank you for equipping us with the courage we need to handle the things that we have to go through. Thank you, Lord. Canaan is in front of us. Canaan is in front of us. Oh, glory to God. God said, look ahead of you. This is where I've been taking you to. This is what the struggle was all about. God said to Joshua, get over this Jordan. Look at it. It's waiting for you. You're sitting here crying, but your destiny is calling you. Everything you believe God for is calling you. And so I pray that God would give you the courage to gather yourself, to move forward, to believe God. I believe that God's going to do it for you today. May the victory of God be yours. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you. Receive the word of the Lord and walk on what he just said and believe God for the greater outcome. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Give God praise again all over the world.
What a powerful and anointed word that we have just received and preached by our pastor, Bishop P.J. Edmund Sr. God has lifted us and he has strengthened us through that word. But now it's giving time. It's time to give. And there are three ways that you can give to Tim Brown Church. First is through Cash App, $Tim Brown Church. Secondly is through our website, www.timbrowchurch.org. And thirdly, through the Givelify app, search the name Tim Brown Church. We have been so blessed this morning that we want to sow back into this ministry and into the Word of God. We thank you for your giving because the enemy has been rebuked and we shall have more than enough. Thank you for your support to Tim Brown Church.
For everybody in the nation this year, lift it up, say, Father.
Father, 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 we praise you, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. We love you, Holy Spirit, yes. We adore you, yes, we do.
Sunday at 11 a.m. right here. If we were together at Tim Brown, we would do our benediction like this. I've been blessed to be a blessing. I've been edified to edify. I leave this service for one purpose only, to serve my community, to grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. Go and change the world for Jesus Christ. Now raise that right hand. I pronounce the blessings of the Lord upon you. I receive it in Jesus' name. God bless you. Until next time.
Hallelujah. We confess that we need you to guide and walk us through. We're in your hands. We're in your hands. We're in your hands. Somebody say, lift it up and say, fire.
Yeah!